What's up, y'all? It's Brother Hondo Solomon coming at you with a new video. See, today's date is October 29th, Monday, October 29th, 2012. I'm sitting here watching a video I got off YouTube from Al Jazeera. And the International Organization of Labor, International Labor Organization, rather, the OIT, there's some of these experts, these economists, they're talking about what these nations are going to do about employment. Because apparently, worldwide, there is a 6.1% unemployment rate. And according to this organization, 40% of those job seekers have been out of work for more than 1 year. They also estimate that, I believe this was created in, it looks like 2011. And at that time, I believe the previous year there were 196 million people unemployed worldwide. They project that this year there are 202 million people unemployed worldwide. Now, see, y'all know that I teach polygyny from an international, cross-cultural, multi-ethnic, and global perspective. With that in mind, I asked myself a question the other day because I was watching some of these clips on American unemployment, and then I began to expand outward in my research, and I'm looking at it like, why isn't anyone discussing the family-based economy? Because just like the whole world is based on an internal-external relationship, microcosm within the macrocosm, that's in nature. That's with the human body in relation to our immediate environment. Why aren't we discussing the metaphysics of economics? They're asking what these nations can do to implement some type of solution to help these people, these individuals. But they're not discussing how individual men and women can join up and form families, because families are guilds and families are also economies. It's a home-based economy. Everyone has talents, gifts, abilities, skills. You can use those skills and combine them, whether you're monogamous, one man, one woman, and you might have a child, you may have no children, but you can form a business. You can then work in relation to other people, and you can sell something, you can barter, and you can create an economy from there. Now, a lot of people believe that everybody should be wealthy. Everybody's not going to have the same measure of material wealth, but by forming families, you automatically forge immaterial wealth, which is spiritual health, psycho-emotional health, physical longevity. I'm thinking to myself, and I'm sitting here eating my kiwi fruit here, and I'm thinking, every family should be able to be healthy, provide themselves with an income, and they shouldn't have to worry about where the next paycheck is going to come from. In other words, working for someone else outside of your family should be a choice instead of a requirement. In most countries now, what they've done, most people are not business owners in the world, not anymore. But economies used to be family-based. And then, remember, we're discussing the metaphysics of economics. The family will do business with other families and individuals. They go to the marketplace, they can farm, they can take what they grow on the farm or what they make from the farm, take that into the marketplace and sell it. And they could work from the home. They could sell food from the home. They could provide themselves with food. There's plenty enough room on the earth to grow food. Desert dwelling peoples all around the world, they eat well enough to be healthy. They usually live longer than Westerners. especially North Americans, Canada, and the United States. Not including Mexico, because Mexico, a lot of people still live according to their cultural traditions. But it disturbs me as I'm watching this clip. This is about a 30-minute clip. They're worried about what the nations are going to do. The unemployment offices. When you have a family, you're never unemployed. I've been unemployed before. And I've even been forced out of a career. I've watched that career die off and change over the past 20 years. In fact, I was a golf caddy for 21 years. And that whole industry has changed from something which was fairly local to something which was co-opted by greedy individuals. So it was no longer something which is organic, something you just did just because it was there. It was pretty easy money. I made a lot of money coming up. But you know, it's time to get out. You know, I have time to work on my books now, so you know, I'm not sweating. But I encourage everyone to forge families. Man and woman, man and women, children. Take everybody's gifts, talents, and abilities and you combine them. So for instance, if you have, let's say you have a wife who makes clothes. And let's say if you're the man and you have accounting skills, where you can do the books for the business. And she can make clothes. Okay, she can hand design clothes and you can market that. She might have some web design skills also, along with her her designing clothes. What I notice about women who design clothes, a lot of times they're into some other art. And a lot of times that's, you know, they may be able to do basic web design. Some of them are graphic artists. Utilize that. If you have a child, you know, even if they're 12 years old, they're young, teach them how to do graphic design. If they're good at drawing, have them sell artwork. Even at 12, they can have their own business, and then that funnels into the family economy. You know, and I wonder sometimes why we don't promote that more often. Because that's the easiest way to have benefits. You know, a lot of times we go after these jobs and say, well, you know, this job has benefits. I got medical, you know, and I have dental. I have vacation time. I have paid time off. When you have a family, you can just get a family insurance plan if you're monogamous. If you're polygynous, what you want to do for insurance, now for a polygynous family, one man, multiple wives, probably some children, what you do is you form a corporation. Go down to your local county office and you create a business name. Now, you know, if I ever engage in polygyny, even if I don't, even in a monogamous family, my family's name is House of Solomon. House of Solomon will be a business name. It will be a corporation. And with a corporate license, we can have corporate medical insurance, right? So make your family into a corporation. Then you got family medical insurance, family dental, family vision. Then you can get around the whole, oh, well, you know, I can't put all my wives on my medical insurance plan. Well, that's if you have family insurance. But if you have business insurance, or you have corporate insurance, and you have insurance for all the employees, hey, your wives are your employees, and you're the CEO. The children are also officers in your business. So, the lead wife, and the lead wife usually knows and understands the man's vision better than the other wives, and she'll be the equivalent of a COO, or chief operating officer. You make one wife a CFO. Every polygynous man should have somebody in the family who is excellent with money. In other words, they're good with numbers. and they know how to shift income around. And they're expert at it. So whether that's you, the man, or whether that's one of your women, one of your Ishas, if you, you know, you're Hebrew. So your consorts should be highly skilled, right? Your family should understand languages. Your family should be at least bilingual, and that's aside from your own language. So actually, that would be trilingual. If you speak English, you know, the most of you watching this speak English as your native language. Okay, then you speak your local dialect, and you should pick up another language. Now, if you're black, if you're black American, if you're African and you live outside the African continent, most people in Africa, from what I've heard, now I've never been to Africa, but from what I've heard, most people in Africa can speak French. And, or at least most of the nations have French as a primary language. So, excuse me, you want to learn French if you ever plan to travel and live within Africa, within the African continent. I would also learn Spanish. Okay? Spanish is very important to learn. Even Arabic. Arabic, from what I've heard from native speakers, is a little more extensive than the other languages that I just mentioned. But it can be learned. Even as an adult, it's mythology that, oh, well, I'm too old, I can't learn a new language. That's false. When you expose yourself to anything for any period of time, it's going to become a part of you. Same thing with languages. That's how children pick up on languages, and that's how they know, for instance, if a child is Mexican and they speak Spanish in their home, the child knows how to speak Spanish. Coming up, they understand what the child understands what his parents are saying, right? So language is part of economics. That's why I went into language. It's part of family economics. It's not just, you know, making money. Remember, money can come and go. You can lose money. I mean, if your family, Pelicans family, loses all their money and all their material assets, what are you going to do? Human capital is the greatest capital, so you can always rebuild, you know. And I don't want the men and the women who have considered polygyny to have the wrong idea. You should never split up over money, because that's temporal. In other words, it's earthly and temporary. It's not going to last forever. Wisdom, knowledge, love, kindness. These are eternal virtues. Okay? Those are the things that are going to help you pick back up in an economic downturn. You know, when the macro economy, the economy outside of you, you know, in your city, county, state, your country, you may live in a province like in Canada. If the macro economy falls, you can still pick back up. Okay? And I've been a nomad most of my adult life, and I've seen what happens when you're just by yourself and there's no support system. You know, I've seen that. At the same time, I have lived communally before. I've lived with other people. I've housed people. People have housed me before. I've been out on my own before. And it's each setting has a different economic structure, and you have to be able to adjust. Now, in the times to come, what we're looking at now is, on most people's part, is a failure to adjust to their situation. So you need to either adapt or die. And most people don't want to adapt. People who are used to making, say, six figures, and then they may lose their job, or for whatever reason, they've had their identity stolen. What if they lost a job, and let's say they've been unemployed for 2 years, 3 years. Some people have been unemployed for 4 or 5 years. It's not that easy to actually find a job out here. It's not that easy, especially if you either, and there's two extremes here. There's people who have no degree, okay? Like myself, I don't have a degree, okay? I have 2 certifications, and I'm about to get another one in personal training. You know, certified holistic health counselor. I'm certified as an iridologist. And I'm about to get my certification as a personal trainer. And then 2 more in the fitness industry after that. And then I'm writing books. So I have something else, you know, going on. And I have to adjust because I was in one industry for, you know, over 20 years. And I remember when I saw things falling apart, that's when I began to really write my books, because I said, okay, this thing is going to just totally crash. And I've been looking for a job since I retired, which was almost a year ago. And, you know, it's not that easy to find a job out here, especially because, again, I don't have a degree. What I found on the other, you know, I mentioned extremes, on the other end of the extreme, on the other end of the spectrum, rather, people who have 2, 3, 4 degrees, a lot of them can't find a job. Why? Because they're overqualified. And, you know, with a lot of these degrees, there's a glut of applicants from this larger pool. So you're getting a whole lot of people going to get a PhD now. And they'll get a PhD like in something like, you know, PhD in economics, which, you know, is a real PhD. However, a lot of universities are cutting down their professorate or their group of professors. They're not giving a lot of professors tenure anymore. And here's how tenure works. I took a class when I was in college. It was called Ethics of the Professorate. And it was taught by a longtime professor at this particular university I attended. He'd been teaching about 35 years. And he explained it. And with tenure, when you're a professor, after 6 years of you being there, you go up. It's called going up for tenure. And it's difficult to obtain tenure because everybody wants tenure. That's the whole point of you becoming a professor, because you get rank. Okay. Now, check this out. Some of you have seen titles for some of these professors, and it'll say professor of such and so, it'll say professor, or it'll say full professor. Then there's an associate professor. I'm giving you these in decreasing order, from top level, top rank, down to the bottom. You have full professor, you have associate professor, you have assistant professor, then you have instructor and lecturer. Okay, and instructors and lecturers, they don't teach much. A lot of universities, they overwork their instructors and their lecturers. Okay, so they're actually having them work more than they normally would, and they're paying them the same as if they were just doing the basic instructor and lecture hours, I guess you want to say. So the class hours are a bit longer, and they're demanding more of them. And this is what I've heard from a former instructor. In fact, when I was in Chinese medical school, there was a woman who sat next to me in my class, and she taught out west. In fact, she had, and we're still in the scope of finance and other forms of economics here, she had a master's degree, a bachelor's and a master's. She was an instructor at, this is like a major university. When she told me the university, I'm like, that's a huge school, very well-known school. And she was also working at a restaurant at night. She was like waiting tables, like in the evenings. And she still barely made enough money to cover her bills. And I know her. She doesn't live high on the hog. I mean, she's like one of those real earthy type women. And I thought it was interesting because she also said she needed social welfare. So she was getting food stamps. And I said, wow. I said, you know what? I said, that's crazy. Because I know how she lives, and I know that she doesn't spend a lot of money. But remember, instructors don't get paid that much. And of course, waiting tables, you know, you don't get paid that much unless you work at really a higher end restaurant and you work, you know, some decent hours. Especially if you have regular customers, you might make a little more then. But excuse me. Anyone who's listened to this and you have firsthand experience, I mean, I would love to hear from you. You know, put it on my YouTube page and in the comment section. Then, you know, I'll add the comment. But this economy right now is against Lone Rangers. So if you're single, which just means unmarried, I mean, there's no such thing as a single person, because you're never truly single or independent. A single woman, single man, unmarried father, unmarried mothers, like, we're all in trouble. You need to be married so that, and to the right people. I'm not saying, you know, guys marry any woman or women marry any man. I mean, ladies, pick a good man. I mean, every woman knows at least one marriageable man. Not necessarily so for men. Okay, most of us know, you know, a woman who is marriageable, but she may not be your, you know, she may not be compatible with you for you know, reasons of character and personality. But any rate, we need to join up and forge those families, because now you're combining your talents. So no matter how talented you are as a man, you're still severely limited in what you can do. And women have the power. One thing about women, and I love this, is that when they get with us men, and every man knows this, you get the right woman, she joins on you, all of a sudden your economy increases. And it's fast. It happens fast because she's playing her role and you're playing your role. You no longer have to reach out and try to delve into these areas where you're doing it just for survival's sake. And that's really what we want to get out of. I mean, in some cases, marriage is a survival mechanism, and definitely polygynous marriage is a survival mechanism. In my book, Blood and Kindred, which is my polygyny book I've been working on, I go into how, you know, you kill and destroy 12 imperial systems that specifically the West, Western European powers have imposed on themselves, on their own people, and on other people. Okay, one of those is prostitution, engaging in polygyny, shoot, engaging in marriage in general, monogamous too. You can get rid of prostitution. You can get rid of, you know, there's no need for you to go to the club. I mean, unless it's a nice jazz club, you know, some nice club you and your wife are going, you know, what have you. That's different. You know, you get rid of, you know, you almost destroy the mental health industry. Because breakdown in mental health in your you know, your adult years, you can always point back to your childhood. It's just that things in your adulthood might trigger it, or is one thing after another, and then eventually it falls apart. But your psycho-emotional stamina is strength is determined by how you were raised, what you were raised on, your values, and your inner constitution. So it's easier for you to experience breakdown in adulthood if you didn't have a strong constitution as a youth, you know. So those are just some tips I'm giving y'all. Hopefully this stuff is helping. But, you know, you tend to build more finances in marriage when people are doing, when you're carrying out, you know, your duties, because it's spread across different people as opposed to you just trying to make the money. So ladies, I was going to give a tip to the ladies. When you marry a man, because we're in a depression, this is not the 1960s, not even 1970s. We're in 2012 as of this date. And you can't demand the same things from a man that you could demand, say, in 85, 1985, 1980, because it's a different realm and you have to be able to adjust. So a man shouldn't have to be rich to be with you. Okay. Most cultures around the world, and again, I've looked at them and I've seen the things they say, I've talked to people around the world, and they're like, well, our women are more apt to build with a man from ground up. Most men in the world are what we would call in America poor or working class. They're not rich. That's most men. Now, ladies, if you want a man who is of means, he got to have his stuff together. Well, one way to help him get his stuff together is for you to join unto him and you fulfill your role while he works on the finances. He works on building your local economy or your family economy, and then spreads out locally from there. You know, it helps. And for the men, you have to have a plan in place. You know, capitalize on your talents and your skills. Like, I'm a writer and a teacher. I love standing before people and teaching classes. And, you know, when I teach my classes, it's not so impromptu as my videos. You know, I actually have everything set up, and it's a lot more professional. But I just had some things on my mind here. But yeah, and I write too. So I'm capitalizing on my talent, and I've got two books coming soon. And so I'm doing my due diligence and practicing what I preach. So guys, again, for the fellas, have a plan in place. Because, you know, if a woman approaches you and she's like, oh, okay, what do you do? And you tell her what you do. Okay, well, you know. And ladies, remember to ask a man not just what he does, but where is he going to be in 5-10 years? If a man can't tell you where at least he wants to be in 5 or 10 years, that means he hasn't sat and thought about it. And a grown man should. You should think about that about where you want to go and what steps you're going to take to get there. That's very important. You should be able to detail that, give provide a woman with details, because she at least wants, women do want security. There's nothing wrong with that. Hypergamy is when a woman marries up economically, or she had, that's, she marries up financially and or an age. So if she's 24 and you're 30, that's normal. Okay. Ladies, you know, only time you should marry a younger man is if he is extremely mature spiritually and emotionally. That's rare. Okay. But normally you should marry a man older than yourself. All right. And this is, again, this is the practice that I've seen in most cultures. All right. But women do want security, but, you know, stressing the financial security in this day and age is unrealistic. And, you know, I've had money before, right? And I financed women before, but it was okay. But I mean, when I looked, and I'm reviewing this now, when I look back at what they were doing to help me build the economy, it wasn't really filling up their days. I mean, I was from before dawn until late at night. I mean, I was working on something. I was either at my job, or then I would come home, I'd run errands, and then I would work on, you know, doing research and things like that, because I was setting up all these books before. And I had some manuscripts before my work was stolen. So it is what it is, but I ended up restarting everything. So you want to be wise in how you move in this world. Don't press all these demands where they're so idealistic you can't deal with the reality in front of you. I'm talking to the brothers and the sisters out there. But marriage, and not marriage through the state, I'm not talking about that. Ladies, if you know of a good guy, talk to him. Call him up like right now. Call him. Be like, hey, look, you know, I know you've been checking for me, whatever, whatever. And talk him up. You know, if he's good marriage material, you will know. Ladies, you know when a man is good and when a man is a buster. You know that. It's not really, it's a lot of science to it, but you ladies do it intuitively. You know who's good and who's bad. Guys, check for that sister. She, and I'm talking to anybody from any ethnicity, not necessarily sisters. But if you know of a good woman and she seems decent, talk to her. Don't be afraid to talk to her. And ladies, be open to that, okay? Be open to that. We know you've gone through stuff. You might have bad relationships, or whatever. But at some point, you need a man. When you ladies go more than 6 months without a man, you experience some serious hormone shifts. I mean, you start to get horny. You know, your decision making, the ability for you to make proper decisions, it declines. Especially if you have children. Women without men don't make sound decisions on a consistent basis. They make better decisions when they're with a man, because you have that balance. You see, you know, I didn't know I was going to talk as much in this video, but I'm probably nearing my time. I'm going to make another video, and I will be posting that as well. So hopefully this video helped. I'll holler at y'all. Peace.